One, two.
But before we start, there is some information about the wireless here. So the network is GastLAN. There is no encryption or password. You don't need it, so any of this. It's open. And well, there is also this piece of information. I'm not sure what what the use of it is, but another port for HTTP and HTTPS, so 80 and 443.
Okay. Yeah, so actually, SSH also I tested it. It works now, but before lunch, exactly the same thing didn't work. So it's worth trying again, actually.
Okay, so now we'll have a talk by Heiner Spotsam about supermassive black hole and LISA, astrophysical and post-Newtonian dynamics.
Yeah, thank you, Mark, and thank you for the AEI and the organizers to invite me here to give this talk. This is too loud. Well, I can put it. It's okay, yeah. So this talk will be a mixture of some general introduction, similar to the previous talks, giving some overview, giving the link to astrophysics, so dynamics of astrophysical objects like galaxies, galactic nuclei, black holes, and then making the gradually the transition, as Mark excellently showed, from the large systems to the intermediate systems where there is two-body relaxation, and then going down to the post-Newtonian dynamics. When we come to the post-Newtonian dynamics, because this is somehow the special topic of interest here for us also and also for this workshop, there will be some scattered plots and things included which are more from the kitchen, from the present work. Yeah, so this is, I will say it then when we have some examples. And also, I think my student Miguel Preto will later extend a little bit about this post-Newtonian work. Now, first, a few acknowledgments. Don't worry, I will not read them all. Well, our institute is a very historical institute, Astronomisches Recheninstitut Heidelberg, which was funded by the Grand Duke of Brandenburg, who is the grandfather ruler or duke of this state, actually, where we are inside right now. In May 10, 1700, has been founded as a calendar institute in Berlin, and then later on moved, actually evacuated by the US Army to Heidelberg. The reason why we are in Heidelberg now is that there is a US Army headquarter. So our former director always said we can be glad that the Americans brought us to Baden-Württemberg, because Baden-Württemberg, till recently, had the luxury of three state institutes doing astrophysics. And but now there was a change as well. Also, the money in Baden-Württemberg getting a little bit scarce. So we are now integrated in the university in the Center of Astronomy. This is the ZAH. And but still, I just keep here the old ARI logo. Okay. In the course of my talk, I will show some simulations which were obtained on our local supercomputer, which is funded by the Volkswagen Foundation. And there's a link to the GRAPE project for those who know what it is. Otherwise, please ask me. And you will see some very common, well-known names, I think, in the list of collaborators. Some of them have been students or postdocs in Heidelberg. And yeah, that should be enough for this. So the structure of the talk will be, as I said, initially something about the astrophysical motivation, that will be here for this time, focused on galactic nuclei and more specifically multiple black holes in galactic nuclei, binaries or even triples. I will less say about single black holes. You have heard something from Mark about it. And I will also less say about star clusters and compact remnants and things like that, which is as well in this context something interesting for us, but I will just not cover it here in the talk. Then there is a very short chapter, which actually probably I will skip some slides, telling details about the very special software and hardware we are using. I like to highlight this because it is a very efficient custom-built special-purpose supercomputer where we are collaborating with the informatics people to actually build our own hardware. That's the reason why it's funded by Volkswagen Foundation, not because of our fundamental research. And anybody who is interested in this should just ask me later, maybe. So then this is the second core part of my talk is the post-Newtonian dynamics. I will show you some examples, how we apply it, how we use it in the simulation. Final thing, gravitational wave detection, that will be not an overview, that will be rather just to show you when we do our dynamical modeling where we are actually with respect to gravitational wave detection. That's okay, so the main motivation, galaxies crash in the universe. You have heard in a previous talk about this. There are many spectacular pictures about this, and there's also a very good ground on reasons of simulations of cosmological structure formation, that we believe that any large galaxies that is present now in the universe has undergone a considerable number, 5, 10, 15 major and a number of minor mergers, something like which can be seen here in this picture of the antenna galaxy. So this is the traditional ground-based telescope picture here where you see two galaxies and some tidal tails. Already in the 40s, Holmberg, with his famous light bulb machine, has tried to simulate these tidal tails, and one had already understood that they are a result of an encounter, of a collision between two galaxies. And due to dynamical friction, actually, these galaxies merge, the nuclei merge. This is a zoom from this picture here with the Hubble Space Telescope now. We see that this is rather complex structure. We have very much gas. We have young stars forming, which we can identify by this bright blue light. And it's actually not so easy. I think here are the two nuclei. And within the nuclei, as you have heard in previous talks, we suspect that there should be massive black holes. Well, this is just two not so often seen pictures of colliding galaxies. So it's also from the observational viewpoint very common that galaxies collide. It's not just an idea of theoreticians. It has been known for many decades. It's only now that we understand what's going on. You have already seen this picture as well. This is famous because for the first time, I think, in a very close. This is actually this is an X-ray view. We see this. This is a false color picture depicting the X-ray intensity measured by the Chandra satellite, and this is a galaxy which already has more or less completely merged. But in the center, we see in a separation of about 3,000 light years, 1 kiloparsec, we see a double nucleus. And here in the X-ray, we see two bright nuclei. So not only in the optical, but we also see in X-ray radiation this double nucleus. And it's generally believed that this X-ray radiation comes from the very hot gas in the vicinity of a black hole and is an indication that we have an active galactic nuclei. In other words, we have a supermassive black hole. So this is, as far as I know, this one was the first direct observation of two active galactic nuclei in a separation of only 1,000 parsecs. So this is interesting for us because we use that kind of situation as initial model for our simulations. I will come back to this in a few seconds. So this is just to give you an overview now. So this was the observation. Now, from theory, this theory of structure formation, which I briefly mentioned before, that gives us actually from the very early universe on, we start with some fluctuation in a dense, hot initial state, and simulating the gravitational evolution of the universe, including the expansion and formation of structure by gravitation, substructures will form out, and then these substructures merge. And this well-known picture of hierarchical structure formation leads to a statistics of how many mergers we expect per unit volume per time. And now, if we assume, which is a good assumption, we think, at least in astrophysics, most people believe in it, that every galaxy more or less contains a supermassive black hole, then the number of galactic mergers also represents the number of black hole mergers what we have. And this is this picture here from the group of Cesana et al. And Cesana, Volonteri, Hart, Madau. And they have done such a statistics of merging galaxies and counted when we have plausible black hole masses, what we expect roughly emerges. And this is actually here the x-axis redshift is something like the distance. So this is our present day universe and this is a high redshift, large distance. And this is the merger rate of black holes per redshift interval per year. And it is in four different mass ranges. So these are the very massive guys here, 0.4 per year in total. So this is the integrated rate. Yeah. So this is what we expect in the whole universe. For the very massive guys, this is 7, then between 10 to 5 and 10 to 7. And 57 if we go for less than 10 to 5. And if we have all black holes, here's a number of 64. But this is actually very, very sensitive to very critical assumptions about the mass distribution of black holes. So maybe we forget about this number. But this gives you an orientation what we expect in the whole universe, how many chances we have to get supermassive black holes together due to galaxy merging. In this paper, which I showed you, very simple approximations have been made, no dynamical simulation, just assuming some delay time and then the black holes merge and coalesce. But as this is actually the problem, I will elaborate now with numerical simulation as well. So the problem is a so-called Stalling problem, which was, I think, first well defined by Beagleman, Blandford, and Rees in Nature in 1980. And the picture is schematically like this. If you have here the logarithm of a time scale and here's the logarithm of a separation, then actually the two black holes coming together after the galaxy has merged, this could be something like the 1,000 parsec, like in the Komosa et al. Picture. Dynamical friction is very efficient, which is something like a reaction of the massive body with the surrounding sea of light objects. So there is actually an energy transfer from the heavy object to the light objects, which we call dynamical friction. And this is very efficient, but it stalls at some moment when actually the two black holes come so close together that only occasionally they have an encounter with a star. So this is the approximation that one object is embedded in a sea of light objects is not true anymore. And then this stalls. On the other hand side, there is the gravitational radiation effect, so the post-Newtonian effect or relativistic effect. When the two objects come close enough together, they will quickly spiral together, but if the separation is small, that actually goes with a to the third power here, so that time scale is very long here and goes quickly down when we come to small separation. The question is how to bridge this stalling gap, and at that time one thought it's probably impossible. Still many people now think it's impossible. Main argument is if you look in a trivial way, in a first approximation, you look at the Schwarzschild radius of a black hole. This is something like 10 to the minus 7 parsec for a 1 million solar mass black hole. And you think, okay, let's be generous, if these relativistic effects play a role maybe 10 times, at 10 times the Schwarzschild radius, we still have 10 to minus 6 parsec. And as you will see, consistent with also with the previous speaker, most of our simulations, the classical Newtonian simulations, terminate around 0.1 parsec. So we have a huge range of dynamic range, which we have to bridge, where there is a gap. Yeah. So how do we bridge this gap? This is actually the topic now of a few simulations I will explain in a little bit more detail. And the initial conditions actually is like this. We are having an n-body simulation, maybe I should stress this, with anything. So we vary the particle number to assess the effect of the particle number of the physical effects. There are some physical effects which vary in a different way depending on n. studying from a few 10,000, maybe 50,000, up to a few million bodies. They all interact with each other because we are in the relaxation regime. Mark explained this, in a two-body relaxation regime for this cusp. And then we put two massive objects, first in this moment, Newtonian, just massive bodies, which are the black holes. They just start somewhere in a separation, 0.6. These are just normalized units. Black holes have 2% of the total mass of the cluster, and this separation is roughly like the 1,000 parsec, which you saw in the Komosa picture. And now then when we go ahead and look what is happening, actually we can clearly distinguish three phases rather than two phases only, which were discussed by Biegelman, Blandford, and Rees. This is just actually, I like to cite this, that we have now newer papers, but this is our first paper on the subject, and still I consider it as some kind of setting the stage for something, so therefore I just highlight it here first, because we just explain a little bit the physics. So we have now 10 times more particles in our recent simulations, but still one could see the basic processes here. Dynamical friction, from the initial separation, we go down to something like about 10 parsec. That's the separation where the supermassive black hole binary gets bound. And then actually we have a phase which we call superelastic scattering, which brings the binary down from 20 parsec to something like 0.1 parsec. And this still, I mean, as you have seen, it's probably, maybe it looks, it's not enough maybe, but it is one order of magnitude, maybe two orders of magnitude we get more by this, what I like to call, sorry, I just nearly hit you with the laser, what we call superelastic scatterings. And these superelastic scatterings are stochastic orbit variations of the binary black hole due to encounters with field stars. Yeah, that actually the field stars carry away energy and angular momentum after this encounter, and the binary black hole gets more bound. And this is what you see here. This is the total energy of the binary black hole as a function of time for different particle numbers, and you see very nicely this linear decay, but it is a stochastic process, yeah, but with a very well-known average decay, that means an increase of the binding energy. So this is helpful, yeah. This is always our normalized time, and there's, when you go to 100, it's roughly 100 is something like 10 to the 8 years. Yeah, this is in principle this is a scale-free simulation, but if we scale it to some fiducial values like a few million solar mass black hole and a typical nucleus, we would be here somewhere at 10 to 8 years, somewhere around here at 100, and one time unit is of the order of the crossing time of one orbit of the star. So million years is one time unit, roughly. And interestingly, already in the 2002 paper, there was a plot of the eccentricity of the binary black hole being very high. Yeah? So just we reach here more than 0.9 of the eccentricity. And that is, as many of the audience here know very well, this is very exciting because that actually will bring down the time scale for gravitational radiation merger very significantly. It is potentially able, if we have 0.9 eccentricity, it bridges this 5 or 6 orders of magnitude from the 0.1 parsec to 10 to minus 6 parsec, because then we will get already GR effects at a much, much larger separation. And now there are follow-up studies of this, and I have here, I don't want to bore you on one hand side, but on the other hand side, maybe just show a few fancy pictures of the orbital structure of these binary black holes. We have actually in a recent work in more detail explored when do we get high eccentricity, when do we get low eccentricity, but this is a low eccentricity case. We see the orbits of the two black holes in green and in red, and here is a more eccentric black hole. You see the motion of the two objects around each other and the motion of the center of mass in the center of the cluster, but this is nothing more than just a few pictures. I think I will just go back. And now, the bottom line of a large number of simulations, which we did published in 2005, was that the initially nice thing actually doesn't look so well when we increase the particle number very much. So what you see here is 1 over A, so this is the inverse separation of the binary black hole. So here is a large separation and here is a small separation. And again, time, 50, you know, 50 was the old simulation. Everything looked very well. We could bridge some gap, but now we have different colors, 50,000 to 400,000 particles. And in 2002, we did something like up to 100,000, so we were somewhere here. And the more particles we take, the slower, actually, asymptotically, the slower the growth get. And actually, also in this simulation, the eccentricity decays and becomes smaller. So do we have a stalling again? Actually, theoretically, it is quite well understood. This is this stalling effect here at large particle number is understood in terms of a loss cone, of an empty loss cone. Empty loss cone is something which is explained in this slide here. It means that when we look at the number of stars which can somehow from far outside reach our binary black hole in the center of the galaxy, so this in somehow this defines a kind of opening angle here in velocity space which stellar orbits can reach the black hole. And now if they reach the black hole, they will do an interaction and be ejected, typically ejected with high energy out of the cusp. So they will be gone away. So after one crossing time, actually, most of the stars in the loss cone will be lost. So if we start with a full loss cone, then actually for some time, the hardening will be proportional to the crossing time because we have enough stars in the loss cone until the loss cone is empty. And it's empty, actually, then the diffusion of angular momenta into the loss cone from stars outside will determine the time scale. So then the 1 over A will scale with the relaxation time, and this is T over N. So this is a much longer time scale. And this is what we see in the plot before. But now we have some very interesting news, because we thought, is this really, I mean, do we need to go to other effects, gas dynamics or whatever is happening? We made a very simple change of our model. That's actually, instead of having a very artificially spherically symmetric non-rotating galactic nucleus, we start that our galactic nucleus initially gets some rotation here around this axis. And otherwise, we don't change much. Actually, also, the rotation is not very large. It's something like maybe 20% of the total energy in the rotation. And this is very natural, because after these galaxies merge, it is very, very improbable that they are not rotating. So this is very natural initial condition. And what happens then is something like in two projections, the time evolution of the initial model. Here we look from the top on this little flattened model. Here is the initial model from the side, so we have some flattening, and we have the two black holes. And then actually we can see with time, there's some elongation, some bar is forming, and suddenly the black holes make it together in this bar. So this is actually connected to the triaxial perturbation of the potential in this object. And as we have heard before, this helps very much bringing material to the galactic center and bringing the two black holes together. Yeah? This is something like the orbital path of the black hole here, starting here and here, and going around like this. And then suddenly they meet in the center, and then there is this superelastic scattering phase again. And now, interestingly, when we look at this, so this is again the same plot. This is 1 over A, so we see the hardening, how it's getting closer, and the time. And this is again 25,000 to 400,000 particles. And interestingly, we don't see any strong dependence on N anymore. So it seems in the rotating system, we have no N dependence. We have always full loss cones. And also, we have a very high eccentricity again. Yeah? So this is very exciting. And I'm not going into the astrophysical discussion of this now. There is this discussion why this happens and how this happens. You can ask me some question about this. I'm skipping actually something about triple black holes. We have some work going on with Pau and Mark and Matt Benacquista on the dynamics of triple black holes. I will skip this maybe for some of the sessions. You can ask this. But the bottom line is, again, if we have three black holes, which is very probable if the first two just don't make it and the third one comes in from the next merger, we will get three black holes. And again, we have extremely high eccentricities here. And now why these eccentricities are so interesting, that is, and how we treat this in the remaining probably 5 minutes or so, what I have, I will. I have 20, but somehow. Oh, that's very good, because somehow then, oh, we started late, yeah. Oh, therefore, oh, sorry, I was a little bit, I started accelerating, but yes. All right, this is fine, I'm very happy with that. Because then that gives me a little bit of time. Now, before we come to the general relativity, just a few words of the supercomputers and super software. As Mark said, it's extremely challenging to even a few hundred thousand or a million particle to treat in the direct n-body regime. This, the total number of operations for one force computation goes with n square. And it's immediately, when you want to do then a few thousand, 10,000, 100,000 of step for your whole system, you get an enormous number of floating point operations. And typically on standard supercomputers, presently, we would probably be somewhere at 10 to 5 particles. And only because of our special hardware, we manage to go to a few million now. And this is just a picture of the special hardware and the postdoc running it in Rochester, by the way, as well as in Heidelberg. So this is my colleague David Merritt in Rochester, actually. He has a similar cluster here. This is the Rochester cluster with Peter Berczyk as a postdoc. And this is the Heidelberg cluster with Peter Berczyk as a postdoc. This is the later picture. So Peter is now in Heidelberg, fortunately. So, and the Heidelberg cluster actually has a peak, has a sustained peak performance of 3.2 teraflop, a theoretical peak performance of 4 teraflop. And it's also, there's something going on. We are working on using some new type of reconfigurable hardware, FPGA, which is probably the special hardware of the future to compute gravitational forces between particles. So this is ongoing work. But the main thing is that we have the classical breadboards in our cluster. So this is maybe best seen here. So we have here our host, 32 of them. And then there are these great boards, which are accelerator boards to compute gravitational forces developed by our colleagues in Tokyo. This is a great project in Tokyo, Makino and others. And this MP-RACE, this is our own development here, the FPGA-based. I will not say much about it, but the main thing is the great board actually delivers gravitational forces between particles about 50 times faster than you could do on a present-day Pentium Xeon PC. Yeah? So basically, one great board, if you have your proper code, which always loads them properly, represents about 50 nodes. Yeah. So if you have a cluster with 32 nodes and 32 great boards, this is something like 1,600 nodes equivalent. Yeah. So if you want to do this with a general purpose, say IBM supercomputer, you need something like 1,600 nodes, and you need the fast network, which is very critical. Yeah, we have a paper about this, but this is not actually this. This is bringing me away. I will not go further into this. Please ask me if you are interested in this. This is a picture here of this accelerator board, just a PCI board which you put in your cluster. And this is the picture how it sits in the cluster here. So this is worth, actually it's the price of about one PC of order of 5,000 euro, an expensive server PC, let's say, and the speed of 50. Yeah, this is how it goes. And this is here the proof as a function of particle number, the speed in gigaflop we reach. This is the RIT cluster, this is the RE cluster here. And if we go to 32 processors, we can reach here about 3.2 teraflop at 4 million particles. This is the last point. Yeah, this is the largest direct n-body simulation I know of in the moment. And you may wonder why this one is slower. That actually illustrates how important the network is. This one uses InfiniBand network with 20 gigabit per second connectivity, and this uses 10 gigabit per second connectivity. Yeah, the reason it's so extremely important. And that's the reason why you are hopeless on general-purpose computers with huge numbers of processors. We don't get the bandwidth, actually. Okay, that's that's all for the computing. It's a very important aspect, and we had to deal with it, because otherwise we were not able to do our simulation. So now we're coming to the post-Newtonian dynamics, or relativistic dynamics, as we need to see how the relativistic corrections to our binary black hole motion, when they come close enough together, when we have these high eccentricities, our final stage at 0.1 parsec, this is actually already a stage where post-Newtonian corrections to the forces become important. And maybe I don't need in this audience to go very intensively over the classical paper in this field. This is actually a kind of orbit averaged treatment by Peters and Matthews in the 60s about how semi-major axis and eccentricity of a two-body orbit would change according to Einstein's quadrupole formula. So that means basically it can give you how much on an orbit averaged sense, how much energy the orbit loses. And what you see here is actually this eccentricity enhancement factor. That's why this is already interesting. So when you see here zero eccentricity and then here maybe 0.9, we are at something even more, well, let's say maybe 10,000 or so is the enhancement factor. So that means here a factor of 10,000, that means the time scale for shrinking becomes 10,000 times shorter if we have 0.9 eccentricity. Yeah? That's already from these 60s papers. One can see the importance of this point. One can see also another point, which is very often taken, that is actually that there is a circularization effect. If we just let the post-Newtonian terms or this kind of post-Newtonian average treatment work alone, there will be a quick circularization actually. So when this is actually, we start here at a large, this is semi-major axis and this is eccentricity. We start at a large separation with high eccentricity and we just only let these two terms work, then we get actually down here, but we pay the price that the eccentricity goes down. So this is a kind of question at that time. When we start with high E, can we keep it at high E? And so this is another interesting thing for the gravitational radiation. I hope in the end I will come back what this means with respect to the LISA sensitivity curve, actually. And that's interesting to see that the power in different harmonics radiated by an orbiting binary strongly varies with eccentricity. If we have a circular orbit, we just have a delta function here at 2. Yeah? At 0.2 eccentricity, we have some contribution from the ground frequency, where the ground frequency is just the orbital frequency, and then we go up to 3, 4, and the higher the eccentricity comes, actually, the more power we get at something, let's see, 0.7, we have a frequency shift of about factor of 10, yeah? Of the maximum power emitted, yeah, and also a higher maximum. So this has to be taken into account. That's maybe more for the astrophysicists, the astronomers. I mean, I'm sure the GR people are very well aware of that. And now we are coming. I'm very sorry. This is the point is, it doesn't matter because I don't want to. I don't want to read the equation anyway, and it should just serve to show you the degree of complexity of the equations. Now, this is now the more modern approach. What I showed you before is the post-Newtonian orbit-averaged approach, but this is the approach really doing an orbital dynamic. So this is much more than the Einstein quadrupole formula. This is actually people, where people stands for Blanchet's group, for Gopakumar, Schaefer, earlier also Soffel in his book. So people have worked on the real relativistic dynamics of two bodies expanding the metric functions into a series. And then there are a lot of complicated problems. I don't know enough really even to say something about it. But at the end, we get equations of motion, which are actually accelerations. So here we have an acceleration, which is a series where the zeros order term is the Newtonian. And then we get here with A and B, velocity-dependent terms and radius-dependent terms, and they depend on various powers, 1 over C squared, 1 over C4, and so on. So this is they look, I mean, just you see how long this is. This goes over 3 pages. So this is rather complex expressions. And actually here, so this is an alternative approach actually to write this. What I showed you before in a slide is something like the acceleration. So we have the acceleration, it's Newtonian, post-Newtonian 1, 2, and 3. And there is actually an alternative approach using Hamiltonians by Schaefer and Gopakuma and others, where we just use Hamiltonians here in this order. And in addition to the Hamiltonians, which describe the conservative terms, we have also dissipative terms. And interestingly, just the 2.5th term here, this 2.5th term, the first dissipative term, this is equivalent, if we orbit average this, this is equivalent to Einstein's quadrupole formula and to the previous treatment of Peters and Matthews. If you go to the 3.5, it's actually more than the quadrupole formula. We now use, for our two-body dynamics, actually, we use this PN1, 2, and 2.5. This means we have the first term equivalent to the Peters and Matthews formulas for the energy loss in our equations. And this is now I show you a little bit from the kitchen, how does this look like. We did first some tests and discussions with our colleagues and friends and just look and check the implementation before we then include it in the larger n-body model. So some examples here. So we start here. This is an XY coordinate plane. We start here with something like 2 black holes. And a Newtonian would be that they just stay forever here on their orbit. And then we switch on the relativistic terms. The blue curve here, this is something like a perihel shift when we switch on the PN1 and PN2, which are the perihel shift of lower and higher order. And then if we switch on the 2.5 term, we get actually a shrinking. It's here the blue and the red curve. Yeah? So you see, and here at the end, actually here we have the time step is not small enough actually in this first picture. Actually, made by Gabor Kupi, and also here we stop this resolution. But then here you see it in the form of a spiral in, where we just have a separation as a function of time. You see the spiral in. Thank you, Mark. And there are some other things. Actually, Miguel, are you going to discuss these things? Yeah, okay, so I will. I was prepared for that, so I will skip this. There's some discussion about how to check the post-Newtonian dynamics, how to check the energies in the different post-Newtonian levels, and that is actually Miguel who will elaborate a little bit more on these points, so I will not do it. The only thing I just want to show you again is here this. This is another spiral in. This is just separation, again, is a function of time, a moderately eccentric object, and this is actually in units of the Schwarzschild radius. And you see we are just doing it well down to the Schwarzschild radius. We have some simulation where we just let these terms go till the objects merge, and we use it in the simulation. And this is the topic of a discussion here, as well as always ongoing. Can one do this? How correct it is? I mean, certainly the post-Newtonian is a serious expansion. It is by no means guaranteed that we have a good approximation already at the 2.5th post-Newtonian order. But I just stole here from Pablo Laguna at the KITP meeting a slide he showed for the accuracy of, actually, this is the energy of the innermost stable orbit as a function of the frequency of the innermost stable orbit. And he was actually making the case, also some other colleagues, but we will hear maybe what is your opinion to this, that when we go from the first post-Newtonian to the second and the third, that we come very close, actually, to the full numerical GR results. Yeah. And this seems to hold for many cases, even for including spins and Kerr metrics. It's my impression maybe still outside, but somehow trying to understand things, that with the post-Newtonian, we are pretty well, to some order, so we are not grossly wrong in description of the global dynamics of the object. And that's why I propose that we use them in astrophysical simulations, where anyway we are not so much interested in the final seconds of the merger and the waveforms, the detailed waveforms. And this is just one example of the application published in monthly notices here in this paper. where we just start for a test, just 1,000 big black holes. We put them in a cluster, we let them orbit around, and gradually they merge by relativistic merger, and this is just the most massive, the mass of the most massive object here from actually 0 to 0.06 in units of the total cluster mass, and this is the time scale. And we see something like a runaway merger, so at the end the most massive object has 6% of the total mass of the cluster. It's just a pure build-up of a massive object by post-Newtonian effects, by relativistic mergers. And this is now the first example how this fits in this binary black hole dynamics. This is the separation of our two black holes in the galactic nucleus as a function of time. And this is one of these Newtonian simulations where we have now some rather, I wouldn't say a stalling, but a strong slowdown of the hardening. And when switching on the PN terms, actually, this is what we expect, that actually at some point we get a very dramatic merger. Yeah? And this, the question is now, what is the right scaling here? And I just wrote here a warning, these are very preliminary results, actually, we are working on that. So for the exact numbers, when this happens here, this is not yet published. This is very fresh work. So this is just more or less only showing that technically we are able now to follow the merger of the black holes in our simulations. But please don't believe the times yet. Okay, so for the gravitational wave detection, I think I will make it roughly to the end. Now, I will now just try to make a relation of what we have been simulating to the LISA sensitivity, so to answer the question, where do we see it? So this is actually the traditional view, let's say. This is Cesana et al. Again, where we see here as a function of frequency from minus 12 to plus 2 hertz, the sensitivity curve of LISA here. And this is something which was a superposition of the background expected from all supermassive black hole mergers in the universe, according to this statistical model, which I showed you in the beginning, where we roughly know how many mergers we expect in total. Yeah? But this was a very simple model. And so this is a breakdown. So this is the same plot, but it is now broken down with respect to the black hole mass, which contributes to different parts of the background curve. These are the very massive guys here, 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 10, 8, 9, 5, 6, 4, 5, and so on. So you see that somewhere here, from 10 to 5 to 10 to the 7 solar masses, we get here these contributions into the LISA sensitivity curve. And the interesting thing is that this slope here is a slope which comes from stellar dynamical hardening. This is actually the superelastic scattering processes, which I showed you in the simulation, create this slope. And this turnover is the time when the gravitational radiation shrinking of the orbit becomes dominant. So then it goes down here. And the point is, this is all for circular orbits. When we have highly eccentric orbits, these maxima will actually go to the right and go up. And the question is, what we have not yet done yet, but with a proper model of the eccentricity of the binary black holes, we would be able to correct this picture, to correctly predict this background. And my point is actually that the eccentricity question is very important for this, that we need more and more quantitative and better coverage of parameter space for this modeling. Certainly, we also need gas dynamics and other processes. This was just one side. This was a stellar dynamical side. And I will also skip one remark, this little innocent cross here. This is the current pulsar timing limit, actually. Yeah. So we, in this triple black hole work, we are expanding a little bit on this. So there are two trends. This pulsar timing is an exciting possibility to measure nanohertz gravitational waves, actually. Please ask me. But so the experimental things, up to the square kilometer array, maybe we get this limit down. And due to our new stellar dynamical know-how that the eccentricities are high, we may get here an overlap. So it is possible that with pulsar timing, actually we have a chance as well to detect these supermassive black holes in the early phase before they come into the Lisa band. Yeah, this is a very interesting perspective. Maybe it's a side issue here. And I think I will just stop with this and thank you very much for your attention. Yeah.
We have time for, I don't know, a couple of questions. Yes, go ahead.
Actually, thank you for this question. We believe at the moment that the reason is in the much more complicated orbital structure. If you have an axisymmetric potential, then it can be shown when you look at the loss cone picture, this is the angular momentum. One component of angular momentum is not enough to determine when a star comes close to the black hole. Yeah, there can be orbits actually with arbitrarily small z component of angular momentum, but they can, these are polar orbits, and these polar orbits always stay away from the black hole, one would think classically. But actually, when we look in more detail, we can see that there is a much larger fraction of so-called chaotic orbit at the transition zone between the axisymmetric galaxy and the spherically symmetric cusp. There is a zone where orbits are strongly chaotic, and it's actually strong angular momentum diffusion starts there, which is not caused by two-body relaxation. And in the moment, we believe that this is the reason, but we have some evidence for that. But it still lacks, say, a quantitative. What one should do is actually make a snapshot of the potential at some moment, and then really analyze the orbit structure. So that we haven't done yet. But that's a possible explanation, possible cause. And this is also a worry, because it may mean that just the stalling is just delayed for another factor of 5 or 10. And if we then really go another factor of 10 in a particle number higher, we have emptied this extended loss cone, and then still we have a problem. Yeah. So this is, in a few words, I think.
Okay, thank you again. I think we, well, is there another question? Well, if not, let's thank Rainer again, and go on.